So you ready to jump in?
Yes.
Do we need to do any kind of like comedic preemptive like little or did we already do it?
No, I mean you got it now.
Because it certainly wasn't very humorous just a second ago.
Took care of it. Let's do it.
Yeah.
Funny.
Okay. Ready, funny.
Can you tell a joke?
That didn't really go anywhere. Can I tell a joke?
Do you have any jokes?
I'm trying to think about, like, if there's anything that's, I stepped in a giant thing of dog poop the other day, but that's pretty normal. Yeah, I mean, what else is interesting? I don't think I have any jokes. I'm, we need your dad for that.
Yeah, my dad.
I wish we could call your dad in for, like...
Tasteless.
Well...
Should we call my dad?
He's of that generation. You could call him and ask him for a joke.
He might be working.
I don't think he'd care.
It's true.
Maybe we do this regularly. I call my stepfather, you call yours.
And everyone would be your like, dad. They're interchangeable.
Yeah, and they're like, guess which dad said the inappropriate joke?
The funniest thing was when I was FaceTiming my dad one time and he didn't realize what FaceTime was. And he had the phone just down. I was like, Dad, show me your face. He's like, oh, I miss you. And I'm like, your face, show me your face. She's like, I love you. I want to see your face too. I'm like, Dad.
He's like, she's pressuring me. I don't know where to go with this.
Still ringing. It's ringing. You must be in class.
Oh, is he teaching?
Yeah, he substitute teaches and all the kids just like call him names and throw things at him.
So how about this? If something funny comes up,
yeah,
just put a little headline underneath and say, this is the humorous part.
Oh, okay.
Right? Just so we can draw attention so people know that we actually, like, clocked in for the humorous part.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Apparently, this is going to be maybe that'll be what it is. The non-funny episode. And it'll be forever referred to as the non-funny episode. No, that could be a good thing. I mean,
that
like, a differentiation.
A long line of...
Oh, you think that...
Like,
but this is scaling the peak, right? So if people question and say, well, which one do you mean? We don't want to speak to you anymore.
Yeah,
so. Let's jump into some stuff going on.
Yeah.
We've got another Tibetan Mastiff in New Orleans, which is crazy. Am I framed? Because I feel like you are more like prominently framed and like this might be a setup of some sorts.
Why would I do that to you?
I don't know. I just think you're trying to steal the show.
Why would I want to steal the show?
I don't know. Maybe you want to show like breastfeeding 101.
Yeah, breastfeeding show.
Anyways, okay. We've got another Tibetan in New Orleans. If you guys follow us or have followed us, you know that we've dealt with a few of these guys. Gus being one of the more severe, intense is a good way to put it, severe cases. He was driven out from, I was gonna say Australia, but that's a really long drive. He was driven out from Albuquerque, New Mexico, if I'm not mistaken, and didn't have to take any ferries or anything that to get over to the mainland.
Yep.
And he went home and he's rocked and rolled. He was a very dangerous dog that we dealt with. And one that really, really put me through my paces. Well, guess that flavor isn't one that he likes. So, can't you flavor the stuff? Like, get some chocolate or something like that? I might be onto something, guys. Let me know if you think I'm onto something. Flavored breast milk? Maybe I'm onto something. So, Cambry, our head board and train trainer down in Nola, and Shelby, who you guys all remember, which we refer to lovingly as Benedict Arnold, she was here for a year and then just scampered on off back to Nola and really hasn't like looked back.
Yeah, and I'm like, how are you? She's like, I'm wonderful.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Really? You're wonderful. You're not lonely. You're not sad. You don't miss us. There's no heartbreak. No, I've got my cat and I've got my dog. And great.
Nola.
Yeah, and Nola. So anyway, so Shelby's down there. Shelby actually was the one, I think, who took the pictures of the Mastiff.
Oh, cool.
So we've got the team coming together. I'm super proud. Like, I can't tell you guys, like, We've been working so hard for how long has it been to like get Nola like on Rocket. Its feet, right? Yeah. We invested a year in Shelby. Like,
yeah.
You hear that, Shelby?
Hear it, Shelby.
A year, so have a little gratitude. A year in Shelby, and now she's back there, and she's in a really good spot.
Yeah,
she really knows her stuff, and I know, I think I've said this in other shows, but between her and Cambry, we have a really tight team down there, and then when I go down there, it turns into like the superheroes of like dog training.
We have a tight team back here.
Yeah. Right? So I'm teasing about the superheroes. But we raise it. It comes up a bit. But then we've got the awesome peeps here. We've got Britt and we've got Henri and we've currently got, and I always want to say apprentice, but it's not. It's
intern,
Miss Liz Krogert. Mm-hmm. Liz is kicking butt. So things are good with that. Everything's going really nicely. That Tibetan, I'm curious to see how, I think this is Cambry's first Tibetan.
Oh, yeah.
And I think he's softer than some of the others.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'll be very curious to see how that goes down. In the interim, or preceding that guy, there's been a gazillion dogs that have been here that have been anti-male. Like, yes, not digging my scene. And so I've had to be hands-on, like much more, you know, like typically, like I'm kind of overseeing and running like business stuff and marketing and content and this and that. There have been dogs, like, so Mozzie stayed in my closet. Mm-hmm. So Mozzie had to like roommate
closet
with me.
Time.
Yeah, closet time. And then we've got Tegan, and Tegan's like, F you. And I'm like, Tegan, don't we have something? And Tegan's like, yeah, F you. And so Tegan's the shepherd, but we are connecting. We're starting to get
there.
She's a sweet girl, but she's very nervous, very insecure, and very fearful around men. Tinge of bratty. Sorry, Tegan, I just have to call it out. And then we've got the big biter, which was, actually, Mozzie was biting up a storm, but...
The corgi,
oh, Milo.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so now we're working with Milo. Milo has moved away from biting feet, which is great.
Cool.
But now he's in that transitional thing that you hear us talk about a lot, which is like, now he's a little unsure. So you'll see Milo kind of like, I don't know what to do because typically I would do this, or you're keeping me in place and I can't move here, I can't do this.
Right.
And if you present feet, he's like, I don't want feet, which is great. So we're really, really extremely happy that he's not going after feet, male or female, but we're working to get him into that spot where he's comfy and like really like kind of like jamming.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it's all moving though. The arc is nice. Daisy, challenging girl. Daisy came down from Oregon. One of those 0.0001%ers as far as like reactivity stuff.
Yeah.
We are like...
She worked with another great trainer too.
And her owners are badass and working their butts off. So... It's one of those things where Henri goes out, so we have female energy walking her and seeing what we get. Then I go out and we get masculine energy and we see like what I get and are they different and this and that. And so we're really trying to work her through and find a strategy that works. And she's like 80-90% better, but she is a challenging dog.
Yeah.
She's one of those that just like the wrong dog starts barking from behind a fence and she's like...
Like, Is she a pity?
Brindle pity.
I was gonna say, I lose my words, but it is. It's brindle. There's brindle pities. Little girl. Is she a small body, sort of like smallish pity?
She's bigger than the other one.
Okay.
Bigger than the other one.
Usually like this skinny type brindle pity. Skinny meaning like really good shape.
Yeah, just fit.
Lean. Yeah, and they just. Are they reactive?
She is one tough customer. Anyways, so we're working through that. It's coming along. Lots of progress. She's been here for a while. And honestly, we've just put our best work into her. And then, of course, as with any dog, and this is the biggest challenge with dogs that are sent to us from far away, we don't know how they're going to be until they go home.
Right.
Please don't put that back in front of me. Oh, God. I hit the donut shop on the way here, so...
Hit the donut shop, like, without, like, it being like, oh, we have a seminar, and you're like, oh, shoot, there's donuts out. Like, you actually went.
Every once in a while, the donut bug just hits, you know?
Wow.
It just hits, and it hit hard. And if they would move Earl's Donut Shop away from Sharky's, so it's not two doors down, I might have a fighting shop. Anyways, that's not important. So... What was I saying? Oh, Daisy. So the challenge, real quick, the challenge is that she's going to be far away in Oregon, and we always know that there's a high likelihood of when dogs go home that things get harder in their home environment with their owners. And so we're going to have to give them some very explicit, very detailed, nuanced instructions, far more so than a lot of the dogs that we deal with, because her protocols and our approach with her are different than a lot of dogs. So we're really working on kind of like putting that together. So fingers crossed for Daisy. She's a great dog. We love her. She's like fun. She's a blast. But she's got dog-to-dog issues, and her reactivity is like some of the off-the-chart stuff. So, but
good owners.
But here's the thing, like, no different than Oakley when I had him.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And my point is, and I did a video on this today, or another day, I can't remember if it was today, but my point is that if you're really committed, if you really want it, you'll find a way. You may not have a perfect dog, but I lived with Oakley for 14 years, and we had a blast and did all sorts of great stuff, and like I was had him off-leash trained where he could be around dogs, right. And you know, so
but
there's
real quick,
there's headroom.
Just to bring up that point, that's hero stuff. Like, we don't expect...
That's diving in 24/7.
Yeah, that's like, just so no one out there has it twisted around, that we would expect, like, only good people would put all this work into. Like, it's an awesome situation, and wow for those owners, and wow for you.
I wanted to be a dog trainer.
That's a huge job. Yeah. So if you're out there and you have had a situation like that in the past that you haven't been able to put your time into like that, or that you're like, you're in that situation currently, I just want you to know that like, they're dogs. Like this is your life is more important in a lot of ways. So just know that like, it's really cool that they're putting their time in, and they must be like some light at the end of the tunnel for them.
And my main point for saying this isn't to say that there's like a magic rainbow kind of like effect, but what it is to say is that possibilities and potential are unknowns.
Yeah.
And that
that's true.
If you and I did a really long post today, a video post that really talks about like that whole kind of dynamic, and hopefully people can check that out. But I rarely give absolutes because dogs have proven me wrong so many times on both sides of things.
Yep.
Dogs that I would say, you can never do this, and they can do it like 3 years down the line.
Yep.
Dogs that I would say, they should be fine, and you have a problem with. So they're dogs, they're animals, like you're saying, you really have to move.
I think I'm just saying there's no judgment from us ever on stuff like that. Like,
not at all.
Tall order.
Not at all. And like you said, it is hero work. It's work where you're like so ready to dive in and just make that your whole thing. So fingers crossed for Daisy and her folks. We're going to give them the very best shot that we possibly can. And you know, like, we have gone all in. So fingers crossed. Anyways.
Shows up. Hey.
Uh-oh. Dad Morgan.
Hey, Dad. Good. How are you?
I'm good. I'm in the car. When did you call me?
Oh, just a few minutes ago.
Huh?
I just called you a few minutes ago.
Oh, okay. So how's everything? How's Forrest?
He's awesome. You're actually here with Sean. Sean's here. Say hi.
Hi. Oh, hey, Sean. How you doing?
Good. How are you?
And we're actually filming Q&A Saturday, so you're actually... The reason we called you originally was I wanted a joke. Do you have any jokes? Because usually we start Q&A Saturday with like some sort of funny, humorous intro, but we couldn't think of anything. I thought maybe you'd be a ringer.
I'd be a ringer on the thing?
Yeah. You're on right now. You're on.
Oh, gosh. most of them aren't really PG.
Exactly.
We'll cut you out. We'll bleep you if you need it.
We can cut you.
The ones I know. Boy, you caught me off guard. Okay.
you can think about it and call me back.
Yeah, let me think about it. I'll call you back. The other issue is I don't want to embarrass myself in front of my daughter.
Well, you will do that anyway, regardless.
I'm less concerned with embarrassing Sean. I've got a joke.
All right.
Okay.
Hello?
Yeah, well, we're here.
Well, this guy... passed on, and he was at the gates of St. Peter.
Mm-hmm.
And St. Peter met him at the gates and said, well, hello, what do you want to come in? And the guy says, yes, I think that I deserve to come in through the gates of St. Peter. And the guy said, well, you know, in order for you to really come through and pass the gates, you, while you were down on Earth, you would have had to have done something very, very good and for mankind, or a really kind deed. And the guy says, well, actually, I can think of one thing I did. And St. Peter says, well, what was that? He says, well, I was walking out of a bar, and I looked over, and there was this big biker group. And this big biker group, this one guy was mishandling a woman and pushing her down. So I went over there, and I said, hey, take your hands off her. And I pushed him, and I kicked his bike over, and I pushed some of the other bikes over, and I showed him and put him in his place. St. Peter says, well, oh, well, gosh, that is a good deed. That is an amazing story. So when did this happen? He said, oh, about 5 minutes ago.
I saw that coming. Oh, that was a good one.
Other than that, I can't think of any real
story. I think that'll do. That'll do for sure.
That's good. It's always kind of cracked me up.
I like it, especially the way that you say it. I can picture your face, too. Oh, about 5 minutes ago.
Or, you know, the other day I got on my talking scale.
Yeah.
And the scale said, I wanted to tell you your weight, not your phone number.
Excellent.
An eighth grader told me that.
was he being rude to you, or was he just telling you a joke?
I heard him telling.
Oh, that's a good one.
That was pretty funny.
That's a good one.
He was kind of fat anyway.
Oh. So. All right. Well, thanks, Dad. We so appreciate it.
Thanks for coming through.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, have a nice Q&A.
Thanks.
Thank you. I'll call you when I'm done.
Okay. Love you.
All right. Bye. Love you too. Bye. This is
fun. So, the book video. Can you share with everybody what went down with the book video?
Yes.
For the pre-orders?
So we did a video last week. We
the put, two of us as
yeah,
we.
Yeah, the two of us as we. And Forrest, I think, was... No, Forrest was gone.
Okay.
That's right. Forrest was the son. So we did a video and we sent it out to those who did a pre-order.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just basically thanking them and showing them the book and doing sort of like a...
Basically,
a little,
it's really there. Like,
yeah.
It's proof.
Yeah,
like,
it's
don't let... I don't want to see you in court.
Exactly.
Like, we're coming with it.
Exactly. So that... that was that.
Yeah.
And yeah, we sent it out.
So we shot a little video and explained where things were at in the process.
Yep.
Some gratitude, like, thank you so much. And
people wrote back. I got a bunch of nice messages, people writing back saying, you know, we can't wait and all that stuff. So that was kind of cool. That was kind of exciting.
Yeah. So things are looking good with that. And the change of foot is just that, like, you're pulling back a little bit from everyday,
TGD
stuff. So you'll probably be seeing less of Laura in the kind of TGD world. She's going to be working on her own projects.
Which they don't
and this
see
one.
Much.
Well,
in pictures and things.
Yeah.
I feel like Q&A is my last standing, like, where I actually feel like I.
You're
visible.
Present.
Yeah.
You're present. Okay. Well.
But yeah. Yeah. So more baby time, more Coyote and the Pig time. And it's also just time. Like, we've got Alexis on, who's
mm-hmm.
awesome.
Mm-hmm.
We've got great interns in. It's cool.
Yep. So, actually, we fired her. So. This is a nice way of saying she's toast. So, no, just kidding. So
I'm around, just not as much hands-on.
Yeah. She's in the, what do you call that? The back logs, behind the scenes. Yeah. There we go. Anyways, guys, what do you say we jump into this goddamn show?
Yeah.
And get this baby rolling.
You know what? I have to say, your cussing went like this. And then it went like this.
Mm.
It did a dip.
It comes and goes.
It does.
It comes and goes. And
it's almost like Feisty Sean came out, and then Feisty Sean kind of like eased back a bit.
It really depends what mood I'm in. honestly, like when I'm shooting videos out there, sometimes I'm super eloquent and easy, and sometimes I'm it just depends the mood.
We should have a different
It's not put on. It's just like
I never said it's put on.
I'm just like, clarifying for them in case they're like, yeah, it's put on. It's like, ooh, you're a tough guy, blah blah.
You know how Beyonce has her like alter ego, Sasha Fierce? We should have your
I don't know about that. Is that what happens when she's annoyed or pissed off?
No, Sasha Fierce comes out when she goes on stage.
Oh.
So Beyonce is everywhere, but when she comes out on stage, I'm single ladies. That's her personality.
And that's Sasha Fierce?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I like it.
So we should have a name for you.
Yeah, like Gary V's got Salty V.
Salty V.
Man, I don't know. Maybe you guys can suggest some alternative titles.
Alter ego.
Yeah, and just know, guys. Like, I know some of you don't like. I actually had somebody on Facebook was like, I don't need any more of that language, and they're like, whoop, they're gone. So it's not for everybody. I get it, and some people are going to be annoyed or taken aback.
The only reason I noticed it is because I have to put the flying husky in.
Right. So here's the reality on the cussing real quick, guys. The reality is that, for one, if I'm worked up, a lot of it's gonna come out. For two, there are times where I don't feel like any other word suffices. Mm-hmm. And that's really like, I can water it down and it feels watered down. There are times where I want to say something and I feel like I'm going to really like shortchange these people. Mm. Like that, literally there's a millisecond of like weighing out the alternatives.
Yeah,
like, do I go lighter and like appease my people, or do I lay the real stuff on and have some people go like, I'm not comfortable with that.
Yeah.
So, and I kind of just, I hate to say it, like, I gotta be me. I mean, I gotta be me. I just gotta do.
You don't have to apologize for it. I just noticed it because I used a lot less answering machine beeps on my cut last week.
Yeah, that's all. So I was probably in a, like.
You were in more of a zone.
I was in, but.
Maybe we should call you, like, the O'Shandy when you come out. Yeah, there's a doghouse.
Oh, Scandy.
Ooh,
scandalous. And there it is.
Okay.
Oh, scandalous. So we'll see how this one goes, if this one gets scandalous or not.
Pregunta numero uno.
I think the donuts mellowed me out, though.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, my blood sugar peaked, a bunch of this, and I think I'm feeling pretty mellow.
Usually that coffee makes you explode.
What do you mean? Do you know, did you watch my Instagram stories where I had to fly out to...
I can't watch your Instagram stories because I'll be sitting on my phone all day.
That's not true. They're only 10-second little things, so they can only add up to so much.
There's 100,000 of them.
No, they can only add up to like 2 minutes total.
Really?
Yeah, because it's only so many you can add. At some point, Instagram's like, hey, buddy, this is stories. Yeah. This isn't like never-ending stories. So,
Instagram never-ending stories.
I woke up with a headache. And I forgot to go do my, I fell asleep last night, so I didn't forget, but I fell asleep.
Bad dog.
And didn't do social media, didn't have my coffee, woke up, headache, and I was like, I wonder if there's any connection. So drove down, talking to everybody, I was like, I wonder, you know.
Yeah.
Had a 3-shot espresso.
Done.
5 minutes later, I was like,
fine.
I feel pretty good. Yeah. So it's not exactly a scientific experiment, but it appears to be, as I said, incontrovertible evidence that we've got a problem. So let's jump.
Question number one
comes
from Miss Raquel. Raquel says, how do you cope with the people who badmouth you, and where does your confidence come from? I would love to set up my own dog training business, and I know I can train the dogs, but I lack the confidence to take the risk and face the haters. What if I mess up and end up with a dog fight, etc.?
Okay. So this is one of the big reasons that we always focus so heavy duty in T3 on personal development stuff, right? So the better you are as far as stability, worthiness, self-confidence, self-trust, the more this is developed internally, the easier any of that stuff or any of those questions that you just asked are going to be to navigate, negotiate, and do it in a way with aplomb, right? So, nice choice, right?
Nice choice.
So, where do you get the confidence? Where do you get the, like, so let me kind of, I wrote some notes, and I know Laura will have some stuff to say about this, but for one, we ban and delete. Mm-hmm. So, if you're contemplating engaging with any of these folks, that's a bad recipe, right? So ban and delete is the way to go. And every trainer that we teach this to, like T3ers, it seems to be like some holy grail that they've, it's so simple, but there's this compulsion to like interact and try and like clarify. Mm-hmm. You know, I get it. All of us want to be heard and understood, and so you want to clarify, and somebody takes your point so completely out of context or completely misunderstands it, and all you want to do is say, no, that's not what it is. Mm-hmm. The reality is those folks that show up on your page like that, they're not interested in a conversation, which took me many years to learn and many wasted hours, and same with Jeff. So they're not interested in a conversation. They're not interested in learning. They're not interested in expanding or engaging or even being kind or respectful. Yeah. So you have to really ask yourself, is this something that's worth my time? Is this something that's worth, I could be doing something with my family, with my friends, creating content, working on my business. And so for us, we ban and delete that stuff.
Get it out of your life.
Yeah. And like I always say, my favorite ones to ban and delete are the really long ones. I take so much joy when someone is like, and we've got this study and blah, 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 blah. And then I just go over and I do this, really. I go. And then I ban and delete them and it's gone. And it just takes that negative crap out of your life. Now, you may have seen in the last like week or so that I actually shared a few things, which I typically don't. I shared some negative stuff that had come towards us talking in a video about the UK stuff. And then I shared some screenshots that a trainer in Scotland had received that were really violent and aggressive and nasty.
Yeah, well,
and
that's so, like, people need to.
Yeah, so for me, that's mission stuff. That's not about me. And I actually talked to that trainer and we were talking about should she share more of that stuff? And I was like, I think you should. I think it's very mission centric, but here's the trick. Don't make it about you. Don't make it about being victimized. Don't make it about I've been hurt or these people are.
Look how mean these people are.
Don't do any interactions with them.
Yeah.
Here's what you do. You want to know the like secret trick? The secret trick is screenshot it, ban and delete it, and then if you want to use, like I told her, then reframe it like I did. Mm-hmm. I screenshotted, I got all the stuff from Alexis, and then Trisha didn't interact with any of these people. Then I reframed it, put it in one post, and said, here's what's going on. Mm-hmm. So they didn't get any, what they want is they want interaction. Mm-hmm. They want friction, they want fight, they want battle, they want validation that they exist and that they're valuable and important. If you don't give
them
that.
That they get your goat, you know, they also want you to, they're bored.
So. Yeah, and that's kind of what I'm saying. And if you don't give them any of that, you become super not fun.
So let me just jump, just because we got a minute. So Raquel, with this, you're going to get hate. There's just no doubt, no matter what business you're in, whether you're doing balance training, whether you're quilting, whether you're saving children, you're going to get hate. It's just going to happen, especially if you're doing bigger things.
Mm-hmm.
So you obviously have to have a tough skin, a thicker skin with that stuff, without losing your, you know, your empathy and without
politeness
becoming hard and becoming like jaded and now I hate people and all this stuff. You just have to know that stuff's going to be out there and just expect it. And if you're not getting it, you're probably not taking big enough risks. The other thing is stuff is going to happen. You're going to, like, say a dog does get hurt.
Yeah.
Okay. That might happen. Go do the best things, the best protocols you can do that stuff doesn't happen, and make sure that you're being safe. I mean, you're the most, you're really responsible person. Like, we've talked to you and we know you and Raquel, right? Raquel.
I don't know if it's the same Raquel.
Oh. Okay.
We don't know if you're responsible.
You might not be responsible. No, but if you dot all your I's and cross all your T's and you're making sure you're doing as best you can, then things, if things do happen, that was the baby, I swear. If things do happen, they're going to happen. And you just have to have, you know, stuff in place where you're like, all right, what can I do better next time? And when those things happen, you're going to use them as information to help you for the next time.
Yeah. So if you're worried that you're going to make a mistake and people are going to clobber you for it, expect that you're going to make mistakes.
Yes.
Only, they can only clobber you if you let them, Manny. Oh, sorry, it's Manny. It's Madhu. I'm so used to Manny, like drinking too much water. What was I saying? So
they're going to clobber you.
Yeah, they're going to clobber you anyways. Your job is just to get rid of anybody that doesn't want, like, my rules are very simple. if you're not respectful, if I get an even like an air of snark, if you're mean to other people, not just me, yep. if you're like on my team and you're nasty, I delete you as well. Yep. So there's just very strict rules. It's my home. You come into my home and you kick the furniture over and you like pee on my couch, you're gone, right? Well, I'm sorry, but it's kind of the same thing. Like, I know it's a little dramatic, but I would love for you to, for one, trust yourself more, do the work you're gonna do. Like Laura said, take all the precautions that you can, but understand that mistakes are gonna happen. And the only people that shrink back from that and don't actually take a chance are the ones that are so beat up and scared by the judgment of others that they never ever do anything.
Yep.
So don't let that be you. Go out, do your thing, ban and delete. Don't give them the joy of what they want as far as the interaction, but capture it and then share it. And share it not from a place of like, this is the bad stuff that's happened to me. Share it from like, I just want other trainers to know that might be struggling
with
stuff.
But this isn't your first thing you want her to do. It's like
No, but I'm just saying like, it's the concepts to be thinking about.
But I would say more than anything, just stay in your lane, do your thing, cross your T's, dot your I's.
She's more practical. I'm ready to blow up the world.
That's the first time you've done that, so that's not like, it's not something that you're like, this is a protocol that we do constantly. That's like just
But I think it's a good concept to think about, taking the power away from the interaction and then reframing it. And honestly, I guess the reason I bring it up is because what's going on right now is so critical.
Is she from the UK?
I think so. Yeah. Or not. But it's so critical that people know what is really going on because things are starting to move, like they're starting to accelerate. Mm-hmm. Florida's starting to get, trying to work really hard on getting rid of tools and regulating dog training stuff. So things are moving fast. I really encourage every dog trainer to stand up, be bold, and put their stuff out there. So anyways, trust yourself and tell everybody else to kiss your behind.
Yeah.
Right?
Thanks. Have fun.
Yeah. Nobody gets good stuff if they don't take chances.
So the last like little
punch.
Button. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, oh, I got that. Gotta say this. Question number two comes from Jacqueline.
Jacqueline, which we do know Jacqueline to be responsible.
Jacqueline says, "Hey Sean and Laura, it's been a while. I'm still rescuing and finding awesome homes.
That right now.
I now find myself being asked to work with feral dogs, usually about a year old, so the avoid humans at all costs instinct has set in deep. Aside from hand feeding, any tips welcome."
Jacqueline, this is one of the hardest things, right? And I don't have a ton of experience with feral dogs. I have been around Jeff's feral dog, Autumn, as have you.
Yep.
And Jeff has had Autumn for, I don't know, going on like probably 5 years now. She's e-collar trained to a certain extent. She recalls and he can have her like off-leash and things like that. But touching her, interacting with her, like he has to like corner her to like put the e-collar on her.
Yeah.
She's still feral. And if you're talking about legitimately feral dogs, getting over that hump to where they feel different about human beings, I don't know enough about the topic to be able to give you any kind of definitive information, but what I know from like the Jeff situation and other trainers I've heard from, it's a very, very, very challenging endeavor it's a very challenging endeavor to try and get a dog that has zero domestication to feel differently about being domesticated. Yeah. And domesticated means like, let's cohabitate, let's touch, let's do all this stuff. So, What I wrote here is first come to terms with the possible limitations, right? Like you gotta make sure you're not in fantasy land of like they can all be great. And I'm sure you're not, but boy, check in with that because it's super duper important. Jeff doesn't expect Autumn to behave like Girl or Kira or anything like that. He's like, she's Autumn. She's like a little bit, doesn't say she's crazy, but she's like, she's a handful, right?
She's actually fine. She just doesn't want anyone to interact with her.
Yeah, yeah.
She's
so,
like, please don't. And Jeff is awesome, so he's like,
he lets her do her thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So that's that. Next strategies, if you're talking about actual training stuff. So food drive, if you wanna try and create something where the dog actually starts to come into you, using treats, food, high value stuff, that's not gonna get you there. Food drive, meaning the dog only eats out of your hand, which is a more complex and time consuming.
She did mention high-end feeding, yeah.
What's that?
She mentioned it.
Yes, she mentioned feeding, but not food drive stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So food drive is basically like the dog has, you build the drive of the dog's food, of feet, of dog eating, and, but it only happens, it only occurs from being fed out of your hand. For dogs that are feral, there's a lot of pressure against that, or a lot of resistance, a lot of like, I don't want that. So there has to come a point where the hunger overrides that, I don't want to be near you. Right. And if things go right, and if the dog's not too far out, you might be able to get the dog to come into you, right, because the food is so powerful. Also, I would do a ton of e-collar work, just recall in, go out, wander around, and be out in open space, recall in, see if she'll take food. If not, no big deal. Mm-hmm. But like a ton of recall to flip that concept, which is, you guys know the concept. The concept is, for feral dogs or any fearful, nervous, insecure dogs, being away from you, comfortable. Being close to you, uncomfortable. E-collar, done right, flips it, right? Now they're away from you, that's uncomfortable. Getting close to you becomes comfortable. Mm-hmm. So that's a big strategy with that. And then combining both, if you can do it, would be really fabulous. I don't know who's moaning and groaning out there. And like I said, the final thing I said, which we already touched on basically, is like, Autumn, Jeff's dog, will never be a normal, typical dog. Mm-hmm. She just won't be. So I think this, for me, like, my most important point for you is like checking in with the realities, the possibilities, and the real possible ceiling that you might hit, rather than putting so much pressure on yourself, like, I gotta get this dog into a regular space. And I'm sure you're not doing that, but I wanna make sure you're not doing that.
Yeah.
Anything?
Yeah, I mean, that kind of, I'm on like his last point. I think, you know, like, you started this out saying like, I'm doing great, rescuing dogs, things are going well, and now you're starting to get into feral dogs. I'm like, that first few sentences may change real quick.
Yeah.
Because the whole goal with rescuing is getting a dog into a home and having it be a win-win situation in terms of the dog being happy and the family being happy.
Yep.
But I can't think of a situation I've ever heard where a feral dog has been like, yay, a domestic house. And the domestic house has been like, oh, wonderful, my feral dog that's like,
afraid, you know, of my kids,
right,
and runs away from, jumps through plate glass windows because they got pressured when somebody knocked on the door.
Right. It's that whole thing of like, almost like it's this weird rescue thing, and maybe I'm wrong about your, I'm not talking about your specific rescue situation, but there is like this weird thing of like, let's take some really difficult situation and like work with it and make it this, make it mission, and then like, and then it's not going to work out, and it's like, oh no. But it's like an impossibility, you know? There's so many great dogs out there.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say is, boy, would I like to see you take that time and those resources and that effort,
yeah,
and put it towards dogs that, God, could go into homes and be great dogs.
Yeah.
And I know it's a sad kind of conversation to think about dogs maybe not being able to get over the hump and living a certain way, but reality is reality. And so each of us have to navigate that,
where are they getting the feral dogs? So that's another thing. A lot of the stories that we hear are more people bringing dogs over from other countries. Mm-hmm. To save, like, why? There's so many here, and I know that's a common argument, but, and I'm not, this isn't towards you, Jacqueline, but just as a bigger picture, why are you taking dogs out of a different country?
Yeah, Jacqueline.
No, but there is that thing, like,
yeah,
let's bring dogs over from a different country that are, have like total culture shock, don't want to be around people.
You know why?
And let's try to force them into a home. Because the story and the whole...
Yeah. That's it. That's why you're so smart. But it's really the story. The story
and
of
not,
a...
And again, I'm not talking to you, Jacqueline, because you may just be like, yeah, I want to just help out.
No, but it shows you how powerful story
it
is.
It really is.
Story,
yeah,
of a dog struggling in a foreign country where nobody cares about it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then people are like, it's just, it appeals to the nurturing human nature.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what we get. So I would love to see you put those resources somewhere where you can help dogs, like we always talk about, like Manny and Belle and things like that.
Yeah.
Like Manny comes out of the shelter and you could put him in any home,
yeah,
and he's safe with everything.
Safe and makes a family very happy. So.
Yeah, I mean, he's lazy, but anyways, okay.
Okay,
let's move on.
Thanks. Okay, question number 4.
Uh-huh.
This comes from Thea.
Hi, Thea.
Thea says, hi. So what would you do when walking two dogs on a lead and a neighbor's dog turns up alone? Evie is not keen on the neighbor's
dog. Must be in the UK or something. Dogs don't turn up here in Chatsworth.
Right. Evie is not keen on the neighbor's dog, as this has already happened a couple times, and she feels uncomfortable because I do. In the past, I've gone to the nearest friend's house and waited for her to pass, but this is not always easy when walking dogs before work. The dog repeatedly escapes, and it's an ongoing problem. The owner is aware. Please help.
Okay. I'm going to do a couple quick little things.
Yep.
I'm going to toss it to you because I know you'll throw down some hardcore Laura Morganisms.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So, first option, have a polite but firm conversation with your neighbor when there's nothing going down.
Yep.
Don't like try and handle this while there's friction or something just post-friction. Contact your neighbor, note, phone call, whatever, smoke signal, let them know. Can we like have tea? You're probably in the UK.
Definitely tea.
Can we have tea? And can we just chat? I just want to chat about the dog situation and, you know, approach it really in a neutral fashion so you don't set anybody off into the defensive world, right? And then show up and then explain what's going on. And if it's a decent person and they have their head screwed on straight and you approach it correctly, you can share that, like, I'm out here with my dogs and I'm walking my dogs and I'm working on keeping them in a good space. And then your dog, what does the dog do?
It just is nervous about the
dog. No, there was a word I was looking for. The
turn up.
Yeah. Then your dog turns up uninvited and stresses my dogs out and stresses me out and kind of harasses my dogs. Now, you may have a really nice dog. This is you talking to your neighbor. And your dog may be bomb-proof, but it doesn't matter. It still scares and stresses us out. So we don't want to inconvenience you. We don't want to say your dog can't have freedom and fun and things like that. But we do have to let you know that how this is affecting us,
yeah.
Right? So I want you to have a great time with your dog, but unfortunately, when your dog's out, it's really affecting my dogs and it's affecting me. And is there anything we can do, like timing-wise, when you're gonna let your dog out or something like that? Look for a compromise. Like, maybe you don't try and shut her all the way down. Maybe you look for a compromise of, like, maybe between 1 and 3 o'clock, you let your dog out, something like that. But it's really gonna depend on, like, her state of mind, where it's at,
yeah.
Or his state of mind, whatever it might be. But like the non-defensive like creation is super important, right. If you want them to hear a word you're gonna say. Mm-hmm. You come over and you're like, you know what your dogs do? Like, you're toast,
yeah.
That's not going anywhere. So then the second part of this is if that conversation goes south and that doesn't go anywhere, then that owner is just determined or just shared with you that they're not gonna own their part of the responsibility of keeping their dog away from you and keeping you safe and comfortable. So then it becomes your decision and your responsibility completely because your neighbor's abdicating theirs. So that means bear spray, pepper spray, pet convincer, walking stick, whatever it is that helps you feel confident and comfortable. And you can look up all those different things that we just listed.
Pet convincer's great because there's no harm to the dog. It's just compressed air. It makes a loud sound. The dog's like, whoa. And the dog might remember, most likely will remember you next time as the one who has that sound.
Yeah, I think you can order those straight off of Amazon.
Yeah,
and they're like $30. They're so worth a try.
And if it's not Amazon, if you can't do, they actually sell them at pet stores. Pet correctors and like in a big red.
Yeah, so that's a different thing. Yeah, so that's a aerosol kind of like canister.
But that works
very similar. Yeah. So you can't replace those. You just have to buy new ones. Mm-hmm. But either one of those are really good strategies. But like people get serious depending on the dog, like bear spray and pepper spray, things like that, and let the dog know, like, it's a drag, like, mm-hmm. The dog is going to take the heat for the owner not being responsible.
Yeah.
But that's the case. Your job is to protect your dog. So first, really nice conversation, really polite, give the person opportunity to reciprocate. Doesn't happen, then you go into protection mode with your dog.
Yep.
And then, like, all bets are off. We start with kind of the least invasive and then kind of move from there.
Mm-hmm.
What do you got to say?
That's really it. I think the dog, if you do issue a consequence with like a pet convincer or something with the dog, if the dog's mild enough, they're gonna, you know, leave you alone next time. I've seen that happen with some dogs that I've like shooed away at the park.
they don't like come running back around back up to me. They're like, oh, okay, she's
it's that lady.
Business. Yeah.
Yeah.
Or you can just always take another route.
Don't take another route. Ask your neighbor to be polite or issue consequences for a lack of politeness.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
All right. Good luck. Question number 5 comes from...
Is there a battery pack on there? Huh? On there? Is there a battery pack?
No, it's a case.
Oh, nice.
Blogilates.
Oh, nice.
Question number 5 comes from Erica. Erica says, Hi, Erica. Sean, I do a little training with family and friends' dogs, and my sister just got her high-energy, 1.5-year-old German Shepherd a treadmill. Mm-hmm. I have 2 quick questions since I've never trained with one before. 1, how long should she stay on it once getting used to it? And 2, how fast should she be going? I recommended that she get one to drain the dog's energy before the walk so they can have a more focused and calm walk, and so she can get exercise on bad weather days, of course. We also just got the Hermspringer prong collar as well.
I think the more important question is, how many hours should I spend on the treadmill after 4 donuts?
After those
just,
donuts.
And the chocolate chip cookie that I stole while you weren't looking. So, I saw. If you have any ideas, like I'm all ears, we could use that as question number 6. How many hours should I spend on the treadmill? anyways, okay, Erica, let's jump in. So, as far as like getting dogs introduced to the treadmill that are nervous about it, that are unsure, anything like that, I always start very low speed. I do leash and prong. Sometimes, depending on the dog, I'll stand off side of the treadmill. Sometimes, if the dog's really kind of like wild and woolly, or be more comfortable for the dog, I'll straddle the dog with my leg on each side of the belt, on like kind of the railings of it. It's not the railing, for whatever the heck it is. And then I'll steer the dog like this, right? So you can either do it from off the side, or you can do it over the dog. Over the dog, you're gonna have more leverage. It's gonna be much more comfortable for you than doing this, right, and trying to hold the dog up there. Basically, you're training the dog with leash and prong on treadmill, almost like the same thing as any other command. Really, it's just about training a dog a position, right? You're using leash pressure to show like the dog, you start slow, always start slow. This thing starts moving, dog's like, what the hell's going on? You gently guide, don't pop. You gently guide with the leash and prong. I need you here. As soon as the dog's in position, release the pressure. Dog starts sliding back, pressure back on, guide the dog into position, release the pressure. Over and over and over again, be super patient, nice and slow. With the speed thing, there's a little kind of magic in there. Like some dogs, especially big dogs, if you go too slow, it becomes awkward for them. They struggle with the tempo. Go too fast and they're gonna panic and freak out. So I'll start slow and I'll watch the dog, and then I'll slowly start to amp it up and see if I can just find like I'm not looking for like a prancy thing right now. This is the introductory thing. I'm just looking for the dog to like, okay, this feels or looks somewhat natural, right? And then start to like increase slowly the speed, and how does the dog look? As you increase it, is the dog like becoming more panicky? It might happen. Keep guiding. But what you'll typically see is as the dog kind of works through the speed, you'll see kind of herky jerks of like, I'm scared, I'm worried. And then, okay, I got this. Then speed it up a little bit more. Oh, I'm not sure about this. Okay, I got this. I don't know why I'm doing this. But basically, that's what you're looking for, is you're looking to just slowly, incrementally get the dog. You're looking to get your dog into a nice, relaxed trot, or even like a nice, good prance. That's the kind of the promised land. And you don't want a dog that's constantly pulling back on the prong collar like that. You want a dog who's in a comfortable space where there's a little slack. You have to stay there and remind until the dog gets into that mode. 30 minutes, probably a good thing to probably a good thing to shoot for. Find the right speed, work it out, be organic. Look for my YouTube treadmill video with a fearful dog. It'll show you how to work through it on the good dog training.
All right.
Guys, see ya. Laura's behind the camera. We gotta go.
Okay. Love you guys.
Bye. Sorry. Bye. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.